Hello, and welcome to the College of St. Rose Founders Day celebration. I'd like to thank the faculty-led St. Rose Camerata for the wonderful introduction to this special day. Dr. Yvonne Chavez Hansborough, Professor of Music, founded the St. Rose Camerata in 2003 with full support from the Music Department Chair, Paul Ivaskovich, and full-time music faculty members. Their audiences have grown significantly over the years, and the ensemble is now recognized as an outstanding chamber music ensemble throughout the Capital Region. I'm Skylar Bull, Vice President of Marketing at Pioneer, a local financial services firm, and owner of the Fort Orange General Store, a specialty retail shop in downtown Albany. As a two-time graduate of the college, I'm honored to serve as your MC for today's virtual event. Preparing for this role has given me the chance to reflect upon my years as a St. Rose student. The outstanding education that prepared me for my career and owning a small business, the many student activities I took part in, including student association and residence life, and most special to me, the lifelong friendships and connections that were fostered on this small plot of land in the middle of Albany. Though I was only a student at St. Rose for a few years, its impact on my life is profound, and I'm sure it is for you too, which is why you've taken the time out of your day to join us for this special celebration, the first in a series of events planned for the college's centennial year. I would like to thank City of Albany Mayor Kathy Sheehan for proclaiming today St. Rose Day to commemorate the significance of our centennial celebration and the profound impact of this institution upon our city. Giving back is a central tenet of St. Rose's teachings, and it's why I choose to volunteer with a group of other alums and friends of the college on the Community of Excellence Committee, which raises funds for student scholarships each year. Someone who has dedicated nearly 20 years of her life to giving back to St. Rose is Marcia J. White, interim president of the college, who is also an alum and longtime trustee. And now, I'd like to welcome her to today's program. Marcia?
Thanks, Skylar. I'm so glad you could be part of this celebration, and I'm honored to serve St. Rose as its interim president during our centennial year. This isn't just another job, it's a calling. In many ways, it's a calling home. I sat in the classroom as a student. I've served 18 years on the board of trustees, and now I am fortunate enough to lead St. Rose at a time when leadership is so important. While we are facing so many challenges, like other colleges and universities, this is also a period of transformation. And shifting with the times is not new to St. Rose. Fortunately, we stand on a strong foundation. The values of the Sisters of St. Joseph of Carondelet, who opened St. Rose 100 years ago. The teachings of my faith say that the person who builds their house on rock rather than sand is wise, and they will withstand any storm. Our founding values are our rock, an orientation towards excellence, education of the whole person, becoming an inclusive community, concern for the dear neighbor, and meeting the needs of the times. And the sisters who created this institution were rock solid themselves. They stepped out on faith and they acted with the best interest of the community in mind. They were always considering, what more could I do to better serve the underserved? It was an inspiring mission that struck me as a busy professional and mother as I sat in a St. Rose classroom finishing my degree. But these values stick with me today. They also resonate with our students. When students visit our campus and say it feels like home, it is because the spirit of our founders is still strong here. It's in the air. Students sense it. It connects with who they are, and they go on to carry out our founding legacy, both as they study at St. Rose and far beyond, as they join the ranks of alumni like Skylar. And because our founders are still so much a part of who we are today, I'm excited to share in this celebration of our story. I would like to thank the sisters who continue to support and pray for St. Rose and who keep us and our history alive. It allows us to understand who we are as St. Rose students, alums and employees of the college, and it keeps us focused on our mission. It is a mission that is as important today as it has ever been. Skylar, I'll turn this back to you.
Thank you, Marcia. I truly appreciate your dedication to the mission of St. Rose and your adept leadership through this transformational time. For anyone who knows St. Rose, it's not out of the ordinary for courageous females to guide our institution through uncertainty. Throughout the past 100 years, the college's leadership has embodied the founding Sisters of St. Joseph of Carondelet in overcoming equally challenging obstacles with gentle fortitude. Their resourcefulness and courage enabled the college to thrive amongst world wars, shifting cultural landscapes, fiscal uncertainties, and yes, even global pandemics. Forming and sustaining an institution of higher education for women in the early 1900s required a great deal of vision, tenacity, and selflessness. I am pleased to introduce to you three sisters who personify these values each day and have prepared a unique and enjoyable introspective of the humble beginnings of our beloved institution. In addition to their time spent at the college as students, each has remained dedicated and connected to St. Rose throughout the years. Sister Kitty Hanley, class of 1961, and Sister Joan Lazinski, class of 1970, and graduate class of 1974, both taught at St. Rose and continue to serve as trustees. Sister Sean Peters, class of 1967, who I'm fortunate to know personally from my time on campus, retired in 2019 as Director of Mission Experience after many years at the college. Thank you to each of you for your continued devotion to St. Rose. Without further ado, let's go back to 1924.
Greetings. We're so pleased to be part of this 100th anniversary celebration for the College of St. Rose. We three Sisters of St. Joseph will introduce ourselves with our affiliations to the College of St. Rose, all three of us are alumna, and then the other roles we have played here over the years. Then we will say who we will be in this presentation today. For we intend to shed our egos and channel three of our sisters who were among the first faculty at the College of St. Rose. These three belong to the first nine on the faculty for the 19 freshmen. Now, isn't that a terrific faculty-student ratio?
Hi, I'm Sister Shawn Peters, and following my two older sisters, Terry Peters Edwards and Sheila Peters Grouse, I also joined the student body at the College of St. Rose. And virtually, I've spent the rest of my life there, except for some time in graduate school and a few years away at another institution of higher education. I served as a faculty member, as the interim associate dean of graduate studies in the Career Center, and most recently, I served as the director of mission experience in the Office of Spiritual Life. So it's been a wonderful time. And now I will be Sister Mary Rosina Quillinan, who was the first dean of the college and professor of math and chemistry.
And I am Sister Kitty Hanley. I'm officially Catherine. Let me reassure you right at the beginning, this is the tail end of an accident from which I am recovering quite nicely. I too am a graduate from the College of St. Rose. I also spent 20 years as a faculty member in the Department of English, and during that time did a brief stint as dean of the graduate school. For the last 20 years, I have been a member of the Board of Trustees, so you will understand that St. Rose is very near and dear to my heart. Now today, I will be channeling Sister Rose of Lima Dolan, who was the first professor of Latin and Greek. And this is particularly significant because of the name of the college, the College of St. Rose. She was the first saint canonized by the Catholic Church from South or North America. So I am happy to have her as my patron, and we are happy to have her as patron of our college.
And I'm Sister Joan Lashinsky. I'm an alum twice over, first in 1970, when I had a bachelor's degree in English and secondary ed, and then again in 1974 with a graduate degree in English. I served on the faculty as a professor of English for almost 20 years, and then have been on the Board of Trustees for the last 25 years. So like Sean and Kitty, St. Rose has been a part of my entire adult life. And today, I'll be channeling Sister John Joseph Moran, who was the first professor of English here at the College of St. Rose. So, something we know about Sister Mary Rosina Quillinan, our first dean, is that she outlined the goals for the first class that came in 1920. So imagine this. It's graduation day, 1924, and the three of us are reminiscing.
Can you believe it, sisters? We've graduated our first class. Who would have believed it? None of this would have happened, of course, without the inspiration of Sister Blanche Rooney. She was a visionary. She had this idea that we should have a college for women, and she had $1,000, so she thought that would be sufficient to get started. And you know, she was not the provincial superior, so she had to go and get permission to start a college. Imagine asking for that permission. But she recognized that it was a big idea whose time had come. And so she went forward.
So they had the idea, they had the permission, and they had $1,000. Their next project was to find a location. They had to find a place. Well, Albany, state capital, seemed really appropriate. And it was really providential that the estate of William Keeler was on the market. Now, the Keelers, as we know, they are big names in Albany. Some people call them movers and shakers. So the property was gorgeous. Well, we've seen it. This grove of pine trees and this wonderful mansion in which we are sitting. People are beginning to call this part of town Pine Hills. And Albany was quite a drawing card. Well, we know. We have students from as far away as Vermont.
Wow.
And Rhode Island. Oh. And I think it's because there is really good train service. Maybe someday we can branch out our recruiting to states that are even farther away than the ones we already have. And now we have this gorgeous house, which is serving us for chapel, classroom, dining room, kitchen, parlor, dormitory, library. So that's how we're here today. Now, Monsignor Delaney, he's the one, he was the bishop's delegate. He came to Sister Blanche with the idea. He had a lot of contacts. He also was a mover or shaker. He helped us get this property. And can you believe we have just completed our first permanent building?
At last.
It is just wonderful. Named for our patron, yes. St. Joseph. Yes. St. Joseph's Hall. Right here on Madison Avenue in Albany.
At last.
It's beautiful. It is beautiful.
You know, that's great, but it also is a little frightening when you think about this endeavor. But, you know, I was thinking the other day, we have a courage among us as Sisters of St. Joseph. And I think back all the way to our founding in France, all the way back in 1650. Those women were brave enough to go out into their city, and as our earliest documents tell us, to do all of which woman is capable. Now, in those days, you will remember, they might not have founded a college, but they taught women who were poor, many of them could barely feed their children. They taught them a trade, that beautiful lace making. And in the 17th century, lace was very highly prized. I keep thinking it was our first example of empowering people through education. And that's just what our college today is. We are empowering these new graduates of ours to open doors for themselves that might not otherwise have been able to be opened without a college education.
Absolutely.
And really, when you think about it, what an inspiration mm-hmm. those first six women were. Really, the courage that they had, the ideas that they had, the creativity that they had. They actually changed religious life in the church. They were among the very first who were not in the cloister. They were out among the people. What were the people needing? How could we do this? And they proved in a way that we need to do again, that women could do much more than society thinks they can, and a lot more than society often gives them credit for. And it really excites me to think of France, to the New World, and to this, what is a relatively new world here in the 20s in the United States.
That's right. That is so true. Just think, as we founded the college, women had just gotten the right to vote, 1919. Well, it certainly took long enough.
That's for sure.
And we saw thousands of women struggling and marching so that a Congress composed of men would finally vote for our franchise. So now, with full citizenship, anything is possible. And let's remember, and we hope our graduates down the years will remember, it's not just for us.
That's right.
It's so that we can help others. You know that lovely phrase from our history as Sisters of St. Joseph, so that we can be present to the dear neighbor.
Yes, yes. And it really makes me proud to think about what values our institution holds. When we thought about this, we thought this has to be a wonderful college.
Sure.
It has to be have a good college name in terms of having a good reputation. Right. It needed to have accreditation. It needed a strong liberal arts foundation for the curriculum. And it had to have very high academic standards. Now, the students weren't too happy about the fact that they had to get a 95 to get an A. Mm. So if you didn't have a 95 or above, you didn't get an A. And if you had 95 to 85, you got a B. You got 85 to 75, you got a C. And after that, it was just conditional mm-hmm. grades. We really had to help those students to think about what they wanted to do, and maybe they needed to study some more. And after a while, they came and they said, we really need to have a B plus and a C plus to give us a little bit more encouragement. So,
you know, Sister Rosina, that grading change, the B plus and the C plus, was your innovation. And I think it was an excellent one. I've heard from the students that they really appreciated that change.
Well, I think it's really important that they get a really fine education. You know, those families are paying $150 a year for tuition. Mm-hmm. That's a lot for them to be considering. And of course, our boarding students have to pay between $350 and $450, depending on their accommodations. But of course, they would also be paying for their children at home, so that's not as bad. But that tuition is a big step for them.
And we wanted this to be a home for these young women. We wanted them to feel welcome. For most of them, it would be their first time living away from home. So we hope they would really enjoy one another. And you know, those are the bonds that are so critical as we move into adulthood. Yes. That's what we wanted to offer and encourage.
You know, and I think that's exactly what our students have found here, a home. Mm-hmm. And I think it's because of this wonderful faculty today who uphold the standards you were talking about, Sister Rosina, but being made to feel at home as you were talking about it. Sister Blanche Rooney and Monsignor Delaney insisted that we have strong faculty.
Absolutely.
I know they got some criticism for that from time to time. But think who we've got. Monsignor John Slattery, who teaches apologetics. Yes. Father Vincent O'Brien, famous for philosophy. Sister Rita Agnes Casey, yes, teaching music. And we all know how famous her music recitals and concerts and soirees are today. You know, Sister Rose of Lima, how much you enjoy teaching Greek and Latin. And of course, you know my passion for teaching writing and literature. And then there's Miss Helen B. Carey, certainly unique among us all, teaching both oral expression and physical education.
When I saw that she was laying out a tennis court with masking tape on the lawn. I thought, there is no limit to this woman's creativity. I also cherish, it's a great image, our students holding golf clubs to practice the grip. They could practice the swing, but they couldn't hit anything because the balls would break the windows.
And who could forget when we hired our Spanish teacher, Señor Balbino Flores.
Oh, yes.
And that's the group. I must say, I'm very proud to be part of that group. Aren't you?
Indeed.
Yes. And when I think, these graduates, the ones we've just graduated, they came as girls, they're leaving as women. You know, that does move me to think back on some of the rules we've had over the past 4 years. Some of them are a little strict. Let me just read them. Number one, students will leave their rooms in orderly condition when going to class. Well, that's good. Also, when leaving on Friday for vacation. Two, students will please refrain from sitting on the beds. Three, students will not go to the city. I think that meant Albany, not New York City.
I think you're right.
Without permission of the authorities. Now, it doesn't say how many authorities had to approve, but it must have been several. Four, students are not permitted to visit one another in their rooms outside of evening recreation. Five, boarders are to study in their rooms during the day so as to leave the library free for the day students. Now, that one does make sense because, as you know, the library is so small that 19 students could not fit in it. Six, loud laughing and talking must be avoided at all times, except for recreation. Seven, eatables must not be kept in rooms, unless they are in tin boxes. And eight, students may receive visitors Saturday and Sunday afternoons. Visitors, we know who they are, must be entertained in the parlors, not in private rooms.
But they are strict. But you know, Sister Rosalima, they're probably not that much different from the rules they would have had if they were staying at home.
Probably.
So I think that they're probably good rules for them, and they've become accustomed to most of them. And perhaps over the years, we could look at some of them, and they might need to change with the way that times change. But I think they're good rules.
Well, Sister Rosita, you know, they're already starting to be challenged by our young women. Let me remind you, if I may, of the notice you once posted, and I quote, "Regulations 4 and 5 are very conspicuous for non-observance.
True.
Evening recreation ceases at 7:30. Kindly observe."
True, true, true.
Well, let me change the subject just a tad. You know, I was thinking about the ceremony, the pageantry, the music. Oh my goodness, it was just wonderful. It makes me so proud. And I'm really proud that the class of 1924 realized they were special. The first class. Actually, the phrase they used was the pioneer class. They developed traditions, and I think they will serve us for years to come. Our college colors and our motto. Now, you know, nothing would make me happier than to say it in Latin, but let me say it in English. In your light, we will see light. That's a wonderful motto.
Yes, it is.
It's inclusive, it's universal, it brings us to the Psalms, and just this past month, we heard the very first presentation of our alma mater. You remember how it started? St. Rose, you are worthy of glory, of praise.
And to sing of your virtues, our voices we raise. To you we owe knowledge of truth most sublime, truths that never can change with the passing of time.
Now, there are two more verses, but for me, the last verse is the most touching. Let's say that one.
Alma mater, your children will e'er faithful be. Oh, do list to us now as we pledge loyalty. And the years that will come, when the days at its close, we shall think of you then, Alma Mater, Saint Rose.
Oh my. Words and Music by our own graduate, Winifred McGowan. Now you know, she is already making quite a name for herself. This is what the newspaper said about her after her concert in June. She received countless bouquets as those in the capacity-filled auditorium applauded the skilled performer. Actually, sisters, I really think it would be fair to refer to these first graduates as co-founders with us. And let's hope it will be true of every class, each one contributing to our proud tradition.
That's nice.
You know, and I'm proud that these students took their studies very seriously. They realized that they were among the first women in our country's history to have the benefit of a college education and the right to vote. They could help shape a better world. And you know, as teachers, many of them, it's so critical to shaping the future.
Yes.
I'm so proud, as you talked about accreditation, Sister Rosina, that these graduates are all qualified, sometimes they say certified.
That's a new word.
Yeah, to teach in any high school in the entire state of New York.
That's wonderful.
You know, and I'm positive, given our desires for innovation, that we're going to continue to add new courses of study. I was thinking, who knows, maybe nursing or music or sciences, but always with the foundation of the liberal arts.
Yes, yes. And I'm really pleased that not only did they really study hard, but they really enjoyed the privilege and the joy of being college students. They really had a lot of fun. And although we're a women's college, they had wonderful dances. They had those tea dances.
Oh, yes, yeah.
And the gentlemen from the other nearby schools would come and they would enjoy the afternoon. And I remember those boat rides on the Hudson River. They were such fun. And that Christmas candlelight procession,
yes,
wasn't that lovely? They did such a good job with that. And then Rose Day. Mm. I mean, to think about having a pageant and having all those young women dressed in all those beautiful dresses. And they just did a wonderful job. And the parents were so thrilled to see them. It was just wonderful to see. And they even helped design the rings.
That's right.
That will
That's
be into the future. They even started a college newspaper.
Did we ever find out why they called it Canary Trills?
Well, I did. I found out. I asked them one day, and they said there was a little yellow bird that came and frequently sat on the windowsill when they were in classes. And they said it just chattered and chattered and trilled and sang. And they thought that it must be bringing the news of the neighborhood. Oh. So they thought that was a good name for the newspaper.
Well, as the English professor here, I have to say, I don't think the title's going to last long. You know, you might not know this, but I've already suggested that they call it the Roosevelt-ian.
Oh, hmm.
I think that that title might have a lot longer staying power.
It might.
You might be right. And did you know, this was so dear, did you know that right after the graduation ceremony, they went out and planted a rose bush on campus?
Oh.
So I hope that tradition continues and that pretty soon there will be rose bushes wherever you look on the campus. It seemed so right.
And I'm so proud. What this first class did was they welcomed each next class. Mm-hmm. They made them sister classes. They encouraged them to be leaders. They turned over planning of some of the activities to them. Just last year, 1923, they started a gala prom at a very well-known new place called, let me think, Wolfert's Roost.
Oh, yes. Mm. Oh, yes.
So.
This is something, really something.
A day like this, graduation day, makes me think, what will become of these young women and all the students who are going to follow them here in the years, the decades ahead? Is it too much to dream that someday this little college of ours might grow to have science labs?
Why not?
And music studios, a big, beautiful library, and maybe even a little theater where my precious Shakespeare might be staged. Who knows? We might need to buy some more of these neighborhood houses for classrooms and for dormitories.
And as someone who teaches other languages, I know the importance of other cultures for a true education. You remember, our first six sisters were told, divide the city to do what needs to be done. I hope our students will divide the world and marvel at the beauty of our world and its many diverse cultures. Perhaps, now this is a dream, but let me dream, we might have students from other countries coming to the College of St. Rose.
That'd be wonderful. Well, you know, sisters, we promised to pray for these students. And we know that every sister of St. Joseph will remember them in their prayers each day. So how are you going to pray for them?
Well, I'm going to pray that our students here would always love getting to know one another. I'll pray that they form fast friendships here that are going to last a lifetime. And I'll pray that they feel at home here and love it here.
That's nice. I think I'll pray that they maintain those academic standards that we started, that they be high, and that they be recognized by employers and by people who are thinking about where they might want to go to college, and the possibility of graduate school. You know, some of our students might go right on and earn graduate degrees. We need women who are in various different professions. We need education leaders. We need nurses and medical professionals, all kinds of health professionals. We need public servants, artists, musicians, writers, business owners. I would love to see our graduates in all those different places. And the list goes on. I'm sure that I'm not thinking of some. We want them to be ready. We really want them to be ready. And I will pray that we continue to attract the superb faculty that we have, you among them. I'm really proud of you. And that we help the students recognize and realize whatever goals they have.
So true. And I believe I'll pray that the spirit of the Sisters of St. Joseph will always be with them. I'm going to get a little emotional here. Forgive me. The call to serve, to change the world, to make things better. And I will pray that they always know how proud of them we are, today and always.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, here we are, back from the conversation our three sisters might have had 100 years ago. We'd like to take just a few minutes to reflect on the dreams they had, and on our reality today.
As the language teacher, Sister Rose of Lima, I was dreaming of diversity, of language and cultures. That is so true of St. Rose. More than 50 countries are represented in our student body. This diversity, you hear it, the clubs on campus, the languages we hear, even the food that's served in the dining room. We are so enriched. It has widened our world.
And look at the curriculum. I mean, Sister Mary Rosina was talking about the curriculum, but she never could have imagined the breadth of our undergraduate degrees and the list of our fine graduate programs that we now offer. I mean, communication disorders and sciences, to social work, to education, including educational leadership. We have a lot of wonderful quality graduate programs, as well as strong undergraduate programs, based, of course, always on the Liberal Arts Foundation. And as the Sisters of St. Joseph have done since their founding, when new needs arose, the college responded with a curriculum that fit those needs.
You know, Kitty, building on your comments, our students take semesters abroad. There are service trips to a variety of countries, including ones that you have led, Sean, to Central America through the Office of Spiritual Life. We do know students come home from those. Their lives are changed.
Absolutely.
They've seen a wider world. And what about the expansion of our physical plant?
Amazing.
Over the decades, house by house, the block has become ours, even across the streets, to become part of the campus.
Not to mention all the brand new buildings that are here around the campus. And although our founding sisters would never have been able to see this far ahead, we know that when World War II ended, male students came knocking at our doors, begging for admission, and we welcomed them. Today, the campus is fully coeducational.
Isn't it amazing what we see today? And now, as we move to the end of these two conversations, what were they like for you?
Well, I came to St. Rose from Syracuse in the late 50s. I had never seen it. I had never been here. But the sisters who taught us in several Syracuse high schools were very enthusiastic recruiters. So I knew that the college had a proud history and reputation, but I really knew very little about it. This conversation that we have just had enriched me and delighted me, and I am even more grateful for the education I received. I was taught by some of the legends, Sister Rose Bernhardt, Sister Jean Pierre Midnight, Sister Alice Marie Welch, and too many more to mention. Quite honestly, I did not realize how well prepared I was until I went on to do doctoral study.
Well, we were living on Long Island, and when my oldest sister was looking for a college, she was looking for someplace that had a Bachelor of Science in Nursing. And she found the College of St. Rose in a catalog. And my father, being a practical man, said, you can't pick out a college simply from a catalog. You have to go and see it. So we were on our way on vacation in the summer. And my father planned the trip so we would drive past Albany. And we stopped at the College of St. Rose, totally unannounced. I'm like 8 years old at this point. And we arrived at the very time in the past years where they had the college literally closed between the part 2 weeks in August. So we arrive in those 2 weeks. And the only person on campus is Sister Emily Joseph. I think she was the only one there. And she gave us a tour like you've never seen. I'm sure we saw parts of the college that most students didn't have the opportunity to see. Well, my sister Terry fell in love with the College of St. Rose, and the rest of us fell in love with Sister Emily Joseph. So when Terry graduated, my sister Sheila was just ready. She graduated in June, and Sheila was starting school in September, and she thought, well, this was a good experience for my older sister, so I'll go there. And then 5 years later, when it was my turn, I thought, well, this is a really sure bet. So I decided I would go to the College of St. Rose, and it was a very good experience. And by then, of course, Sister Emily and my parents were great old friends. They'd been together forever. And I had some wonderful teachers. I had Mr. Cronin for history. I had Miss Fenn for biology, who was a legend in her own way. And of course, Ruth B. Johnson for education.
Perfect.
Well, I'm an Albany girl, a graduate of Vincentian High School, down two blocks from St. Rose. So I knew a lot about the college and hoped someday that I might be a student there. I was, like many people in my class, a first-generation college goer. That dream, as you heard, has been fulfilled twice over for me. And I went on to doctoral study, well prepared, as Kitty has said, by the faculty and staff here at the College of St. Rose. I, too, had legends of the next generation, including Sister Noelle Marie Cronin, Dr. Swaminathan, and our very own Kitty Handley. As we come to the end of these conversations, there are a few people we should thank. First of all, the staff from the College of St. Rose who arranged for and videoed this piece, Kim and Mike and Todd. We thank the St. Rose 100th Anniversary Committee who invited the three of us to engage in this conversation. Finally, deepest thanks to Rose Marie Mannery, longtime history professor at the College of St. Rose, and author of the volume called Of Glory, Of Praise, which she wrote for the 75th anniversary of St. Rose. It was our primary source, though we took some liberties with it. It's been a joy for us to share these reflections with you.
I am blessed to serve St. Rose as its interim president during our 100th anniversary. May students throughout the next 100 years be blessed in this special place. Happy birthday to our founders, the Sisters of St. Joseph of Carondelet. Happy 100th anniversary to St. Rose.
Happy 100th birthday, St. Rose!
Happy birthday, St. Rose!
Happy birthday, St. Rose!
Happy birthday, St. Rose!
Happy 100th birthday, St. Rose. Class of 1984 rules.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Congratulations, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday.
Happy 100th.
100 years, St. Rose. Congratulations.
100 years. Cheers.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy 100th birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday! Happy birthday!
Happy centennial, St. Rose. Enjoy the celebration.
Happy birthday, St. Rose. Here's to 100 more.
Happy 100th birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose!
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, College of St. Rose.
That's the nice thing.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy 100th.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy 100th, St. Rose. Many more.
Happy 100th birthday to the College of St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose. Cheers.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday.
Happy 100th, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy 100th birthday, St. Rose.
Happy birthday, St. Rose.
Happy 100th birthday, St. Rose.
Anyone else feel like they need a glass of milk? Thank you to so many of you that submitted video clips. I hope you had as much fun as I did. During this landmark year, St. Rose is going through a period of transformation, building upon the momentum created by new offerings, including the 2-4 program, in which students can earn a bachelor's and master's degree in 4 years, and the return of nursing, a field which St. Rose was a leader before the program was discontinued in the 1950s. But as the college shifts to meet the needs of today's students, it moves into its future while holding strong to its roots. The St. Rose mission of excellence in education, development of the whole person, creating an inclusive community, service to the dear neighbor, and meeting the needs of the times speaks as strongly in today's world as it ever has, if not more so. It's why over 45,000 alumni, including myself, are proud to be part of its century-long legacy, and are confident that it will provide a life-changing educational experience for generations of students to come. Before wrapping up today's program, I want to highlight a couple of the exciting events and projects the Centennial Committee has been working on. In conjunction with the virtual Reach Out St. Rose, the college kicked off 100 Hours of Service, a challenge to each member of the St. Rose community to log 100 hours of serving the dear neighbor between now and June 2021. Whether you volunteer time on a nonprofit board or knit hats for preemies in the NICU, it all counts. Completed projects will be recognized during the culminating centennial celebration on Saturday, June 12th. If it hasn't already, a special centennial edition of the St. Rose magazine will be arriving in your mailbox soon. You'll find all sorts of fascinating information, including a sampling of 100 years, 100 faces, a fold-out timeline, essays by legacy families, and so much more. The magazine, developed by St. Rose's talented marketing team, is a memento to treasure. Speaking of mementos, the College of St. Rose Alumni Association has launched an alumni shop featuring centennial apparel and accessories for all the St. Rose fans in your life. The Centennial website, which you can navigate to from the St. Rose homepage, is the hub for all of the centennial programs I just mentioned, the Proclamation of St. Rose Day, and so much more. So be sure to check it out and check back often for continuing updates. Lastly, I want to thank the Founders Day Subcommittee, with special recognition to Nancy Sandman, class of 1970, and Kim Lynch, Director of Event Scheduling and Administration, for the many hours they dedicated to pulling this special program together. And thank you for tuning in to celebrate 100 years of the College of St. Rose with us today.
St. Rose, you are worthy of glory, of grace, and to sing of your virtues our voices we raise. To you
And in the years that will come, when the day's at its close, we shall think of you then, alma mater, St. Rose. Winifred McGowan, the composer, was the first student to earn a Bachelor of Music degree within the context of a classical program. The meaning and spirit of her words are as much a part of the St. Rose experience today as they were then. Thank you to the students and alumni from the music department for reminding us of its resonance in 2020. And thank you to sisters Joan, Kitty, and Sean for the reflection on St. Rose's founding. In these unprecedented times, we're so fortunate that the conversation could be filmed in person. Despite these hard times, we celebrate this milestone anniversary with joy and hope for our future.